Hello and welcome to the Edmonton Bone and Joint Center's virtual preoperative teaching session. In this video, you will learn about your hip or knee replacement surgery. Please note that there may be some paperwork referenced in this presentation that you have not yet received. You will get all of this documentation when you come into the clinic. You may note that some of these slides have page numbers on them. These match up with the page numbers on your surgical booklet. Please feel free to follow along with your book if you have it on hand. Your surgery is a pain reduction surgery. You were not guaranteed to be pain-free, but we want to make you better than you are now. We want to improve your ability to perform your activities of daily living. You will not be able to run marathons or do high-impact activities, so you will be low-impact for life. This means no running, jumping, or any other high-impact activities. You want to protect your new joint, because if it wears out, you may require a revision surgery. There are movement precautions. You will be taught those while you're in the hospital. A note on kneeling. You may be able to kneel after having knee replacement surgery, but it may be uncomfortable. This is normal. You can contact your case manager about whether or not you are allowed to kneel after your surgery. Here's a list of the documents you should have on hand prior to your surgery. These will be valuable resources pre- and post-operatively. These documents include your teaching book, either the hip book or the knee book, the surgical pathway document, the pain management document, the goals of care, which we also call the green sleeve, the scrub, your dental form. If you have not already completed that and had it faxed back in, we need that before we can give you a surgical date. And finally, your patient surgical agreement. Things to bring to the hospital. First, a small suitcase. Your hospital stay is about 1 to 2 days. Bring loose-fitting clothes like comfy pants, as well as pajamas, socks, and underwear. Bring personal care items like a toothbrush, soap, shampoo, and deodorant. Make sure you bring the appropriate non-slip footwear that is adjustable in case of swelling. Tie-up running shoes work well as they can adjust for said swelling. Do not bring open-toe or open-back shoes as they're a tripping hazard. Bring all of your prescription medications in their original containers. Bring your CPAP machine if you use one. Be sure to bring your teaching book, your green sleeve, and surgical pathway for reference. Please note, AHS and Covenant Health are not responsible for any lost or stolen items. Surgery happens out of 3 sites: the Orthopedic Surgery Center, the Misericordia Hospital, and the Alberta Surgical Group. Your team will provide you with your surgery date in advance, as well as its location. If you are being operated on at the Orthopedic Surgery Center, the hospital will call you the day before surgery between 2 and 6 p.m. to deliver your arrival time. If you are being operated on at the Misericordia Hospital, they will call you the day before between noon and 2 p.m. If you are being operated on at the ASG, they will call you the day before. If they do not call you, please call the number for your hospital that is listed on this slide. These numbers can also be found in your surgical pathway document. Getting ready. To reduce your risk of infection, you will be provided with a pre-op skin scrub to be used in the shower the morning of surgery or the evening before. Instructions can be found on page 18 of your teaching book. Shower like normal. At the end of your shower, turn the shower off and use the scrub for 3 minutes on the surgical joint. This slide shows you where to scrub if you are having your hip or your knee replaced. Then, turn the water back on and rinse off. Towel dry. Eating and drinking guidelines. Eating. Do not eat anything after midnight. Please eat a final snack before you go to bed, either a piece of fruit and a cup of cereal with half a cup of milk, or a piece of fruit and a slice of toast with jam and half a cup of yogurt. Drinking instructions. If you are being operated on at the Orthopedic Surgery Center or the Misericordia, you are allowed to drink see-through, clear liquids until 1 hour before your arrival at the hospital. Examples of acceptable fluids are water, apple juice, cranberry cocktail, black coffee, or tea. Do not add milk or cream to your coffee or tea. Do not have any alcohol 24 hours prior to your surgery. Do not drink diet, sugar-free, low-calorie, or energy drinks. If you do not have diabetes, drink 2 cups or 500 milliliters of clear apple juice or cranberry cocktail 1 hour before your arrival at the hospital. If you do have diabetes, drink 2 cups or 500 milliliters of water 1 hour before your arrival at the hospital. Remember, stop drinking 1 hour prior to the arrival time given to you by the hospital. If you are being operated on at the Alberta Surgical Group, no eating or drinking after midnight. Please book an appointment with your family doctor for 1 week after your surgery once you've received your surgical date. This is so you can get refills for any pain medication you may need, as we cannot refill those here. Even if you don't end up needing the refills, it is better to have this appointment booked and then cancel it, versus struggling to get an appointment on short notice. You will have a 2-week nursing follow-up back at the clinic if you live in Edmonton or the surrounding areas, and this will happen at a local hospital or family doctor if you're from out of town. Then, we see everyone back at the 6 to 10 week follow-up appointment. At this time, you'll see your surgeon and the physical therapist again. At 3 months, the physical therapist likes to follow up just to make sure that there are no issues. What to expect after surgery? Swelling. Everyone can expect some swelling. This is why we encourage elevation 2 to 3 times a day for 45 minutes each time. Make sure to keep your bed as flat as possible. Elevate your entire leg up on pillows, as is found in your book, so that your foot is above the level of your heart. Keep your knees straight. Ice for 15 to 20 minutes, or less depending on tolerance, at least 3 times per day. Cold therapy is highly recommended, but not required. Bregg cold therapy machines are sold at our joint assessment clinic, but frozen peas or corn or ice packs work as well. What to expect after surgery? Pain. You will have some pain after surgery. You'll be given pain medications after surgery. Make sure that you take them if you need them. If you wait too long, it can be very hard to control the pain. You are given a prescription for pain medication when you are discharged. Your goal is to wean yourself off of narcotics for the next 1 to 2 weeks after your surgery. Everyone's pain is different, and you may need more pain medication than what you get on discharge from the hospital. This is why we suggest booking an appointment with your family doctor in advance once you know your surgery date. Tylenol is used as an adjunct to make the narcotic work better. If you have Tylenol extra strength, you can take 8 of those over the span of 24 hours. If you have Tylenol arthritis, you can take 6 of those over the span of 24 hours. You may be able to take anti-inflammatory drugs such as Advil, depending on your home medications and the blood thinner you are put on post-surgery. This will depend on your surgeon. Complications after surgery. Blood clots. Blood clots are rare, but they do happen. They can occur in the leg or in the lungs. You will be prescribed blood thinners to help prevent these. They may be taken orally or by injection. Regardless, you want to look out for any signs of blood clots. In the leg, this looks like increased swelling in the leg that doesn't go away, or your leg gets red, hot, tight, discolored, and you have calf pain. If these occur, please call your case manager, as you may need to go to the emergency room, or we can try our best to have you booked for an ultrasound to have that assessed. If not, we will be sending you to the hospital. Sometimes the clot can travel to your lungs. So if you have any chest pain, shortness of breath, or trouble breathing, please call 911, as that is a medical emergency. Another complication after surgery can be infection. Infection is rare, but it does happen. When it happens, it can be catastrophic. If you have any of the signs and symptoms of infection, you should call your case manager right away to have it further assessed if it is business hours, i.e. between 8 a.m. and 4 p.m. on weekdays. If your incision becomes red, hot, swollen, if there's any foul-smelling drainage or any drainage from your incision, if you have increased pain, fever, or chills, please call your nurse. If your dressing or bandage is not intact or is leaking, please call your nurse as well, as we can give you dressing change instructions. If you do have an infection, the earlier it is caught, the easier it is to treat. If you are concerned and it is outside of business hours, please go to the Royal Alexandra or Misericordia emergency rooms to be seen, as those are the sites where we do our joint replacements out of. Another issue after surgery is constipation. This is mainly due to the narcotics you're taking and your decreased mobility. On your prescription sheet, there are medications to help, and they are also available over the counter. We recommend Senecot and Peg. If there are other methods that work for you, such as fiber, fluids, Metamucil, prune juice, probiotics, etc., do that. Still having issues? Contact your pharmacist for recommendations, as they have easy access to whatever you may need. If you have any questions, please contact your case manager. The number can be found on the back of your surgical booklet. If you do not have the direct line on hand, please call our front desk at 780-433-3155 to be directed to your surgical team. Getting ready for surgery. Your in-person teaching session will allow us to measure you for the equipment you will need for surgery and to ensure you have a plan for who will help you once you get home from the hospital. For now, here is an overview of the information you will need to know for preparing for and recovering from surgery. Your allied health professional will determine equipment which may be available from a loan site in your area. This equipment may include a toilet seat razor, shower seat, and a two-wheeled walker. If your area does not have a loan program or does not have the requested equipment, you are responsible for arranging your own equipment before your surgery. This may require renting or purchasing some equipment. Please have your equipment set up at home 1 week before your surgery. Some types of equipment are not available through loan programs and will need to be purchased. This may include dressing aids, crutches, canes, hip cushions, or cold therapy machines. We will indicate loaned and purchased equipment on your Allied Health Surgical Patient Agreement and provide you with an area-based vendor list. You can make your hospital stay easier by practicing your exercises before your surgery. These can be found at the beginning of your teaching booklet. Move through the range of motion you have and work up to 10 repetitions. If you can't tolerate sets of 10, decrease the number of repetitions until you can tolerate them. Remember, quality over quantity. Make sure to check your Allied Health Surgical Patient Agreement to see what equipment you need to bring to the hospital. You will receive a copy of this at teaching. Bringing in and using your own equipment decreases the transfer of germs in hospital. Make sure to label your equipment with your name and phone number. In the hospital, you will be up on your feet and walking with your two-wheeled walker a few hours after the surgery. You use either crutches or a walker for 6 weeks following surgery. Most patients are allowed to put as much weight through their surgical leg as they can tolerate. The rest of the weight is divided through their arms on their walking aids. Expect pain and swelling after surgery. These need to be controlled. Use your pain medications before your exercises. Elevate the leg and use ice after activity or exercise. You will be discharged within 1 to 2 days of your surgery. You could be discharged in the morning, afternoon, or evening, so you will need to have your driver ready to pick you up. Cold therapy options. Cold helps to decrease pain and swelling around the surgical site after surgery. You can decide between cold gel packs, homemade ice packs, using snow or bags of frozen veggies, or a cold therapy machine. Cold can be applied for 15 to 20 minutes at a time. Your skin will require at least 40 minutes of warm-up before reapplication. If you decide to purchase or rent a cold therapy machine, a prescription for this can be provided. Some cold therapy units are insulated containers which you add water and ice to, and the cold water circulates to a cuff around your joint. Other types of cold therapy units use an ice pack with a compression wrap. Different options available are indicated on the cold therapy information sheet. Become familiar with how to use your machine before your surgery. When you get home. When you are discharged from hospital, you will be independently mobile within your home, but you won't be moving quickly or have much energy. You may need to change positions frequently and avoid being on your feet for more than 10 to 15 minutes per hour. It is normal to be very tired for the first few months after joint replacement. You will use your crutches or walker for the first 6 weeks, then transition to a cane until your limp is gone. Your exercises may be difficult after surgery. It can be a full-time job for you managing your exercises, icing, and elevating your leg. Be sure you have plans for who is going to help around your house with cooking, shopping, yard work, driving, and laundry. AHS provides some funding at contracted physical therapy clinics. To utilize this funding, you have 12 weeks after surgery to start physio. You do not need to attend physio at these clinics. If you prefer to go elsewhere, you can utilize your private benefits or pay out of pocket. After a hip replacement, you should choose to sit on firm or higher seats or chairs with armrests that are easier to rise from. You may want to use long-handled dressing aids for reaching past your knee. If reaching past your knee, it is important to move slowly and carefully, avoiding letting the leg twist or cross the midline, like you do when reaching laterally from your chair or reaching into the back of your vehicle from the front seat. Some surgeons have their patients follow more rigid movement precautions, and these will be taught to appropriate patients during the teaching session. For knee replacements, avoid twisting over a planted foot. Also, avoid forced knee bending, full squatting, or kneeling positions for at least 3 months. Thank you for taking the time to watch this video. If you have any questions for our allied health team, please contact them at 780-377-1432.
Did you know that the nose is home to thousands of germs? In fact, it's an ideal breeding ground for many bacteria, viruses, and fungi. These include harmful infection-causing germs like influenza, coronaviruses, Staph aureus, and MRSA. As we breathe and touch our faces, these germs easily spread not only to other areas of our bodies, but also to surfaces and people around us. Even as we clean our hands, bodies, and other surfaces, the germs in our noses keep spreading and recontaminating these areas. This exposes us to potentially serious infections when we have a wound, a surgical incision, or a weakened immune system. But what if these harmful germs could be eliminated before they leave the nose? Introducing Steriwave Nasal Photodisinfection by Ondine Biomedical. Steriwave is a painless, 5-minute treatment that uses a special light-activated liquid that's scientifically referred to as a photosensitizer to safely destroy bacteria, viruses, and fungi living in the nose, including superbugs, while keeping your human cells unharmed. Here's how it works. First, the nostrils are swabbed with the Steriwave photosensitizer. Like a magnet, the photosensitizer, which has a positive electrostatic charge, attaches itself immediately to germs, which have a negative charge. In contrast, human cells have no charge. At this point, nothing's happening yet. Then, the nostrils are illuminated with a Steriwave light. This specific red light is safe, unlike UV light. When the photosensitizer is activated by this light, it creates a cascade of reactive oxygen molecules that physically tears apart the germs. Our own immune system produces these same molecules to fight infections, but Steriwave does so much faster and in much greater quantity. Bacteria, viruses, and fungi are simply unable to defend themselves or develop resistance. When the light turns off, the reaction stops. As soon as the Steriwave treatment is finished, the nose is sanitized and germs can no longer spread to contaminate other areas and cause infection in ourselves or others. While there's a lot of science and engineering behind this world-leading non-antibiotic alternative, it's quick and easy to use, and it's already been proven in leading hospitals to significantly reduce infection rates, length of stay, readmissions, and antibiotic use. Painless, safe, powerfully effective in minutes, even against superbugs. Steriwave Nasal Photodisinfection. Strike infections before they start.